Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. In this video, I'm going to discuss about sex determination from skull and mandible. In my previous videos, I have discussed about sex determination from tissues, that is using the cell DNA, right? By using techniques like nuclear sexing and all the other sex verification tests, right? But what to do when DNA is not present, in absence of DNA results, or if we are not getting any DNA result, then what to do? Then we are going to use the skeletal remains. So in that case, skeletal remains can be used to infer subject's sex via two methods, morphological and anthropometric, right? The morphological approach is based on the examination of the bones that show the strongest sexual dimorphism, that is the bones that can easily help us differentiate between a male and a female. So the mainly the bones that we use are skull, mandible, pelvis and sacrum. In this video we are going to discuss about these two, that is sex determination using skull and using mandible. Now here's a table that is showing the accuracy of sexing based on the skeletal remains. Here we have the skeletal remains that we use. If we are studying the entire skeleton, then there is 100% accuracy of the sex that we are getting in the results. If we are using the skull and pelvis, then there is 98% accuracy. Pelvis alone, it is the best bone. If only one of the bone is to be considered for determining the sex, it is the best single bone and it gives up to 95% accuracy. If skull is used alone, then it gives us 92% accuracy. If long bones are used, then 80 to 85% accuracy is there. And if long bone along with pelvis is studied, then it gives us 98% accuracy. So now let's start with the sex determination using the skull. So for that we need to know the basic differences between the male and female skull, right? That's how we can differentiate that, okay, this particular skull belongs to a female body. So if we talk about the general appearance, then normally the male skull is going to be larger, heavier, rugged, and it has marked muscular ridges, whereas the female skull is small, light, and the walls are thin and smooth. So if you look at this picture, the overall appearance of male skull is larger than that of the female skull. Then if we talk about the forehead, then male forehead is receding, irregular, rough and less rounded, whereas female skull is vertical, round, full, infantile and smooth. If you look at this picture, if you look at the forehead area in male, as you can see, it is kind of sloping, right? A slopy area is what you can see, whereas in female the forehead is kind of vertical, right? It is vertical. Then if you talk about the cranial capacity, then it the male skull is more capacious. It has 1450 to 1550 cubic capacity, whereas female skull is less capacious. Capacity is 1300 to 1350 cubic capacity. So basically you need to remember all these points. Question can be asked from anywhere. Any kind of feature can be given and it can be asked if this particular feature is prominent in male skull or in female skull. Any kind of question can be, any twisted question can be asked from these points. So you need to know each and every difference between the male and female skull. Then if we talk about glabella, glabella is basically the area that is present between the eyebrows or between the eyes. So glabella is quite prominent in males. Here you can see it is like this, right? Whereas it is not prominent in females. Then if we talk about the supraorbital ridge or the supraciliary ridge, so it is prominent in males and it is less prominent in females. Supraorbital, we know that what are orbits? Orbits, these are the orbits, right? Orbit is the bony socket of the skull in which eyes are located, right? So the supraorbital ridge is basically, supra means above, so this area is basically the supraorbital ridge. So it is prominent in males and it is less prominent in females. Then if we talk about the frontonasal junction, then it has a distinct angulation in males and it is smoothly curved in females. So here we see an angle formed, but here it is curved. If you talk about the orbits, then the orbit in male are square, they have rounded margins and they are smaller in size, whereas in females the margins are sharp, overall shape is round and it is larger. So in male it was square, in female the shape is round. The margins are rounded in males, whereas they are sharp in females, and the overall orbits are smaller in males, whereas they are larger in females. Then if you talk about the frontal and parietal eminence, the eminence is less prominent in males, more prominent in females. If you talk about the zygomatic arch, then the zygomatic arch is prominently, you can see, in the males it is prominent, whereas it is not so prominent in females. Then the occipital area is prominent again in males and not so prominent in females. If we look at this area, this is the occipital area, this is the occipital bone, this is the frontal bone, right? This is the parietal bone, this is the occipital bone. So here we have, in males we have a prominent occiput, whereas it is not so in female. Then if you talk about the mastoid process, then that is larger, rounded and blunt in males, whereas it is smaller, smoother and pointed in females. Here you can see there is a larger mastoid area, right? Whereas there is no such case in here, there is just a small mastoid. Then if you talk about the digastric groove, it is deep in males and it is shallow in females. If you talk about the condylar facet, then it is long and narrow in males and it is short and broad in females. If you talk about the palate area, then it is large in males, U-shaped and it is broader, whereas in females it is smaller and parabolic. Foramen magnum is relatively large in males and longer also, whereas it is small and round in females. And if you talk about the external auditory meatus, then the bony ridge along upper border is prominent and it might even be absent in females. So these were all the differences between the male and female skull. Now let's talk about the male and female mandible. So the general appearance, if we talk about, then the mandible of male, mandible is basically the lower jaw, right? So the lower jaw of male is larger and thicker, whereas in female it is smaller and thinner. If you talk about the chin or symphysis menti, then the chin is square or U-shaped in males. If you look at this picture, here you can see that the chin of the male is kind of U-shape, right? Whereas it is rounded in females. Here you can see it is rounded, right? Then the angle of body with ramus is less obtuse in male, or we can say it is more prominent. Here you can look that the angle is kind of like this, right? Whereas it is more of like this in female. If this is a 90 degree, then the angles that go here are acute and the ones that are more than 90 degree are obtuse angles, right? And the angles are going to increase in this direction, right? So here we have less obtuse angle in male, whereas it is more obtuse in female and it is not prominent. If you're going to talk about the angle of mandible, or also known as gonion, then it is everted in the male mandible and it is inverted in the female mandible. So at the genoid, male crania, the muscle attachments are going to curve outward, or they're going to evert from the surface of the mandible. So hence the angle of mandible is everted, whereas in female it is going to invert. So it is inverted in females. Then if we talk about the body height of symphysis, then it is more in mandible, male mandible, whereas it is less in female mandible. Ascending ramus has greater depth in male, whereas it has smaller depth in females. Then the ramus flexure, rearward angulation of the posterior border of the ramus can be seen, whereas here in this case it is straight. And if you talk about the muscular markings, then they're going to be prominent in male mandible and not so prominent in female mandible. So these are all the points that can help us differentiate between male and female mandible, and these are all the points that can help us differentiate between male and female skull. In my next video, I'm going to discuss about male and female pelvis, which is the single bone that gives us the best accuracy in the sex determination process. So do watch that video also. This was all about this video. Thank you for watching.